Audible Studios presents Beat the Crowd, How You Can Outinvest the Herd by Thinking Differently, written by Ken Fisher with Elisabeth Dellinger, narrated by Brian Holsopple. Preface. True confession. I didn't want to write a preface for this book. It's too darn long already, and I wanted to spare you hearing one more minute. But alas, the powers that be require one. Who knew? Maybe that's fitting, because this is a book I didn't think I'd write. I was happy with 10 books. 10 is a round number, and plenty. I didn't think the world needed another Ken Fisher book. But ideas happen. An idea struck during a conversation with my former Wiley editor, Laura Gatchko, still with Wiley, no longer saddled with my silly nonsense, and my co-author, Elisabeth Dellinger. One thing led to another, and next I knew, I was at it again. 11 is a fun number, too. The concept of contrarianism has run through my books since Superstocks, way back in 1984, but I've never overtly addressed it. To me, contrarianism has always been about independent thinking, and my books have always demonstrated this. At least, I like to think so. But that fateful December day in 2013, it occurred to us that I'd never come out and explained just what the heck contrarianism is, isn't, and how to practice it. I realized it was time, since contrarianism is misunderstood and misapplied by many, and unknowingly practiced by some who might like to know it. Most assume being contrarian means doing the opposite of what everyone does. If everyone is mostly wrong most of the time, betting the opposite must bring success. Sometimes that's true, but often not. Opposite doers have a herd-like mentality, too, and the market loves fooling them as much as it loves fooling the crowd they're trying to game. Real life isn't herd versus contrarians. It's the mainstream herd, the opposite-doing herd, and the independent thinkers, real contrarians. They see what both herds think, then weigh all extant factors, pluses and minuses, and reach their own conclusions. This book is a how-to guide for anyone tired of rules of thumb, media hype, and industry mythology, and wants to think independently. It's a brain-training guide. Not foolproof, but foolproof doesn't exist. This book simply teaches the thought process that helped me be right more often than wrong for over 4 decades of money management. You can be right more often than wrong, too. This book was a team effort. As just mentioned, Laura helped generate the idea and provided early edits before passing the reins to Tula Batancheff, who edited the lion's share along with Judy Howarth and the rest of their team at John Wiley & Sons. Vincent Nordhaus led production at Wiley. Wiley's team was diligent and patient as always, and I remain grateful to my excellent agent, Jeff Herman, for leading me to them. Jared Kriz, Michael Olson, Lauren Scheckman, Eric Harger, and Nathaniel Beeman, who have worked with me for years, also provided ideas. Thomas Perez designed another cool cover, capturing our theme perfectly. Jessica Wolf, Chandeep Madan, Sam Olson, Michael Leung, Tom Schluter, Brad Piles, and Talia Hosenpud helped with research, while Jared, Todd Blyman, Jill Hitchcock, Justin Arbuckle, and Molly Leanish weighed in on early drafts and helped steer us toward a sane path. Todd pulled triple duty, editing the entire book for content and shouldering most of Elizabeth's workload and providing her unquantifiable moral support while she shelved much of her day job of writing for my firm to devote her time to this project. Christopher Wong and Emily Dunbar, up-and-coming writers at my firm, helped with copy edits. Last but not least, Fab Ornani, David Eckerly, Christopher Boaz, and Theodore Gilliland led our PR and web marketing. To all of them and anyone I failed to mention here, and to my wife, Sherry Lynn, and broad family, I give my deepest thanks. And thanks to you for listening. May you enjoy this as much as we enjoyed writing it. Ken Fisher, Camas, Washington. Chapter 1. Your Brain Training Guide. Few truths are self-evident, but here's one as close as they get. In investing, the crowd is wrong much more often than right. Most folks accept this. They remember pain from some of their own mistakes. More so, they recall market-bloodied friends, relatives, neighbors, and co-workers. They've seen all the famous market gurus get egg on their faces. Academic studies show the wisdom of the investing crowd as folly. Yet, folks follow along anyway. For most, it's impossible not to. The financial blogosphere, websites, and cable TV talking heads pound market groupthink into our brains 24/7. Without conditioning yourself to resist, it's all too easy to accept repeated falsehoods as fact, melt into the crowd and buy high, sell low, with the rest. There is another way. Train your brain to battle the media, the crowd, your friends, neighbors, and cocktail bankers, and think differently. It doesn't take vast market knowledge, a finance degree, an economics PhD, or endless rigorous study. Armed with a few basic principles, internal alarm bells, and an instinct for independent thought, you can be a true crowd-beating contrarian investor. Yogi Berra once quipped, "Baseball is 90% mental, the other half is physical." Might apply to investing. Mental discipline is key to success. See this book as your brain training guide. You'll learn tricks you need to protect your brain from media hyperbole and some principles to outsmart the crowd. What does being a contrarian mean? What's the secret to being right more than wrong? Prepare to find out. In this chapter, we'll start with the basics. Why Wall Street's definition of a contrarian investor is wrong. The foolishness of conventional wisdom. The true contrarian's gut check. Wall Street's contrarian contradiction. Legend lumps all investors into two categories, bulls and bears. Those who think stocks will rise and those who think stocks will fall. If the masses are bullish, Wall Street says anyone who's bearish is a contrarian. If the masses are bearish, bulls are the contrarians. But this is wrong. It implies everyone, one big crowd who thinks stocks will do one thing, and everyone else, another crowd thinking stocks will do the opposite. Everyone else often thinks they're contrarian. They think everyone is the herd. And the herd is always dead wrong. They've seen the countless academic studies showing the majority of investors are just terrible at making investment decisions, usually selling low and buying high. They believe doing the opposite of the crowd guarantees buying low and selling high. Problem is, everyone else is as crowd-like as everyone. Their opinions usually aren't unique, and their analysis often isn't any broader or better than the main crowd's. They look at all the same things, just with a dissenting, condescending sneer. People thinking this way and that they're contrarians aren't any smarter, any more discerning than you or me or the crowd. Their moves rarely pay off any better. That's the bad news. Here's the good news. You can be a real contrarian. Once you know what leads the crowd, or both crowds, astray, it isn't hard to think better and act smarter. It's impossible to be perfect, but to be better than most isn't so hard. The Curmudgeon's Conundrum. Two herd contrarians see the world like an analog clock. They base bets on wherever the main herd expects the hand to land. If everyone says the clock will point at 1, the supposed contrarian herd bets it'll land on 7, roughly the mirror opposite direction, just because it's the opposite. Contrary for contrary's sake. Much of the time, no real extra thought goes into it, just a curmudgeonly instinct. Everyone's cheery, so I can't be. It wouldn't occur to curmudgeons to consider other alternatives, like everyone's cheery, but maybe they should be even more so. This isn't physics, where for every action there is an equal and opposite reaction. Assessing markets and events based on a false either-or could lead to big mistakes when you consider results are not binary. Transferring our clock metaphor to stocks, if the crowd thinks stocks will rise 10% in a year, the curmudgeons bet on down. Perhaps not down 10% exactly. They'll bet on the opposite direction, but they might not bother guessing the magnitude. Their nature is to be ornery, but not ornery with precision. Simply betting the reverse direction is good enough for them. We can transfer it to a recent scenario, too, like the Federal Reserve's quantitative easing, QE. The crowd thinks QE is good, propping up stocks. Contrarians think it's bad, risking inflation. Here is your false either-or. In my view, QE is bad because it is deflationary, an outcome neither the crowd nor the supposed contrarians consider. There is a century of economic theory and research supporting this notion, but the crowd buys the common narrative, which crowd contrarians are so fast to categorically reject that they miss the truly big problem with crowdthink. There, too, they're just being an opposite crowd without much deep thought. More on QE later. What's the problem? A clock doesn't have just two numbers. It has 12 hours with 60 minutes in between. Even if the masses bet wrong, the curmudgeon has a 10 in 11 chance of being wrong, too. That's a 1 in 11 chance of being right. Same goes with markets. If everyone calls for a 10% year, stocks need not end down for them to be wrong. Flat returns would do it. So would up 20%, 30% or more, because most who envisioned 10% would have sold out by the time stocks hit 15%. The curmudgeons who bet on down could very easily be wrong, and often are. Not that being wrong would hurt if you called for 10% and stocks did 30%, if your positioning was right and you didn't sell too soon, but we'll get to that in Chapter 2. There is always a but. The market is the Great Humiliator, TGH for short. Its goal is to humiliate as many people as possible, as often as possible, for as long as possible. Preying on the herd is its bread and butter. Humiliates a whole bunch of investors at once. The crowd is the easy, typical prey, but TGH spares no one forever. Even true contrarians get whacked. No approach works all the time, including assuming the crowd is wrong. Sometimes they're right. The market usually doesn't do what everyone expects, but there are always exceptions. If TGH didn't let the crowd be right sometimes, there wouldn't be a crowd. Momentum investors, those whose guiding principle is the trend is your friend, would be proven wrong the moment they invest. Markets would slap most folks in the face as soon as they buy or sell, and people would learn from their mistakes. Stocks wouldn't have anyone to fool, and fooling folks is one of the market's greatest pleasures. People must be right sometimes, must feel good sometimes, or we'd never have a herd. They would just give up. The occasional rightness fosters false confidence, reinforcing the crowd's wisdom. It is plausible deniability for TGH. It is how TGH repeatedly sucks the crowd in, makes them ignore negatives, then doles out maximum pain and suffering. TGH probably then enjoys a cartoon villain-like laugh. This is why seasonal myths like sell in May and September is the worst month ring true. Even though they're wrong more often than not, they're right sometimes. Those times when May, summer, and September returns look sad, coupled with below-average historical returns for May through September, keep the myth alive. Occasional and often dramatic rightness gives myths power. Markets often let the crowd look right temporarily before turning on them. Folks who believed the Eurozone crisis would end the bull market in 2011 looked awfully right that October, when world stocks were at the bottom of a deep correction. But stocks bounced, and the bull carried on in 2012, 2013, and beyond, shrugging off history's largest sovereign default in Greece along the way, ultimately proving the Euro doom mongers wrong, or very untimely, also effectively wrong. Sometimes markets' wobbles let folks think they're right, like when a correction comes after headlines warn some big evil will rock stocks. Corrections, sharp drops of negative 10% to negative 20% over a few weeks or months, come any time, for any reason or even no reason. But fearmongers often assume conveniently timed corrections are proof that whatever they warned about was as big and bad as they said. This isn't fundamental rightness, just confirmation bias, seeing what you want to see, a dangerous behavioral phenomenon. But most folks don't bother differentiating between fundamental rightness and happenstance. More on this in Chapter 9. Just as the crowd is sometimes right, true contrarians are sometimes wrong. Everyone is wrong sometimes. The goal is simply being right more often than wrong, as opposed to looking right at first, but ultimately being wrong more often than not. Why most investors are mostly wrong most of the time. It isn't because they're uninformed. It isn't because they lack smarts. Very well-read, bright people who pay close attention to the market often make pretty bad investing decisions. There is usually one simple reason for this. They inadvertently get sucked into consensus views. Groupthink can happen no matter how careful and studied your methods are. Many folks see investing as a discipline, art, or science, which sounds good, but their methods morph into conventional wisdom, usually dangerous in investing. All operate on various sets of beliefs about what is and isn't good for stocks and when you should and shouldn't trade, or they follow rules dictating the same. Many doctors, lawyers, and engineers are prone to this, not because there is anything wrong with them as people. It isn't their fault. But their professional training leads them there. In their professional lives, they use a rules-based methodology, and there it works. But in markets, it doesn't. For doctors to recommend a treatment, they need scientific proof it works, trials and controlled tests. They apply the same methodology to investing, looking for rules that have been back-tested and proven to work. Most lawyers are logicians by trade and nature. They expect markets to follow rules, processes, and simple logic. Most engineers, too. They expect markets to be linear and rational, just like the systems they build and work with daily. Rules-based investors usually use similar logic and reach similar conclusions. They use the same patterns, the same if-then assumptions. They end up expecting similar things, and it morphs into a consensus viewpoint. It usually appears very logical, but markets often defy logic, as we'll soon see. Other folks take their rules and beliefs from academic theory and textbook curriculum. Theory and textbooks aren't inherently harmful. Principles and theory can be useful if you layer on independent thought, but many turn theory to dogma, textbooks to rule books. Whatever the literature says is good or bad for stocks must be true, always and everywhere. If the rule book says high price-to-earnings ratios, PEs, and high interest rates are bad, then they're bad. To fundamentalists, the canon is often truth, but canon is also widely read, more consensus. Markets price in the consensus pretty quickly and do something else. That something else is what the true contrarian wants to figure out. Some investors use old saws and rules of thumb as a guide, the playbook. Here, too, the approach might seem fine. The playbook is supposedly full of time-tested wisdom. If it didn't work, it wouldn't be in the playbook. But the more you base decisions on maxims, proverbs, and things everyone just knows, the less likely you are to think independently, and the less likely to have true contrarian views. The playbook also doesn't pass a basic logic test, one of the true contrarian's favorite tools, as we'll see in Chapter 4. It includes familiar adages like, buy on the dips. When stocks are on sale, snap them up at a bargain. But that's also when the playbook would tell you to cut your losses, get out of that dog before it goes to zero, and get into something that's actually going up. One page tells you to let your profits run, If it's going up, stay in. It'll keep going. Yet the next page tells you to take some profits off the table. Which do you choose? Both sound intuitive. If a stock is running, you want to let it run. But you know it could easily run off a cliff, plummeting with legs churning like Wile E. Coyote, so pocketing some of those gains seems wise. The playbook doesn't tell you which play to run. Not all rules of thumb are based on price movement. One age-old playbook trick claims to have the secret for profiting off company announcements. You've heard it. Buy the rumor, sell the news. If the rumor mill says Apple is working on a sexy new phone that operates telekinetically, opens your garage door, feeds your kids, and locates distant planets, all while you're on the phone with long-lost Aunt Sally, whom your phone found all on its own, buy. Don't wait to find out if it's true. Get in before it's too late. Then sell when they announce it, after all the other suckers have piled in. As if it can't possibly go up more. As if the company has zero potential lift, will never do anything new and cool again ever, and maybe even do something else with another rumor right after that new phone is announced. How could you know? All of these approaches rest on widely known information and common interpretations of that information. No matter how intuitive and logical, they're what everyone does. The true contrarian moves beyond consensus views and conventional wisdom. Life is way more exciting there, in the wide open air. Love or hate the media, they do you a favor. Mass media reflects and also influences sentiment, and most of it has become steadily more groupthink, in my view, over the last two decades. Journalism today embodies John Maynard Keynes' old maxim, "Worldly wisdom teaches it is better for reputation to fail conventionally than to succeed unconventionally." It wasn't always so. Pre-internet, pre-cable, journalists often had distinct views. When you had three major national news networks and a handful of major national financial publications, pundits competed with insight. They wanted to be groundbreaking. Now we have dozens of 24/7 cable news outlets, scores of financial websites, and countless blogs, and every article and blog post has a comment feed where anyone and everyone can roast the author publicly and anonymously. Nothing attracts a roasting like an article far out of step with mainstream thinking. It drives the wingnut in the crowd into posting internet terrorism, which cowers and moderates authors, melding a groupthink media. In some few realms, increased competition isn't always uniformly good. But there is a big silver lining. Modern media makes it pretty easy to spot widely held beliefs and mass sentiment. The media will only rarely quote anyone outside the herd or anti-herd. I experienced this firsthand whenever journalists asked my opinion about quantitative easing, QE. You've probably heard of it. It's a program the Fed launched during the 2008 financial crisis, an effort to boost liquidity and lower long-term interest rates so businesses and people would be eager to borrow. For years, the Fed bought treasury bonds and agency mortgage-backed securities from banks and paid with newly created electronic reserve credits. Well over $2 trillion of supposed new money. These purchases lowered long-term rates, and banks were supposed to use the new reserves as collateral to magically multiply money supply. When journalists asked my opinion, I told them what they didn't like. Something outside the herd or anti-herd. When you reduce long-term rates while short-term rates are pegged near zero, you flatten the yield curve, shrink the spread between short and long rates. We have more than 100 years of evidence confirming a wider spread is the real magic. Why? Think about bank lending. Short-term rates are banks' funding costs. Long-term rates are their lending revenues. The difference? Long rates minus short rates mimics a bank's gross operating profit margin. Banks aren't charities, they're for profit. The more profitable lending is, the more they'll do it. The less profits, the less eager bankers are. They'll sit on their hands. just like they did all through QE. For years, the herd thought the Fed was the only thing propping up growth. In reality, the Fed killed lending and gave us the slowest loan growth in decades, almost no growth in the quantity of money, also known as M4, a point almost no one noticed, and the slowest gross domestic product growth since World War II. I explained all this to reporters in vast detail with data. It made sense, they said, but they didn't print it. If everyone said QE was a loose money policy, how could they publish some wacko saying it wasn't? They couldn't, because the wingnut part of the crowd would crucify them. Major outlets wouldn't, couldn't print such a view on QE. In an age where seemingly every quoted expert, the Fed, the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, and every finance minister and central banker in the world said QE was a big economic lifeline and ending it was the biggest risk to the global economy, journalists would have to be out of their minds to differ. The commenters and bloggers would tear them to bits. It would be career suicide. This makes it easier for real contrarians to sort through the media. There are always exceptions, but in general, it is pretty safe to assume that if headlines hype something, it isn't a contrarian view. It won't tell you anything you can act on. For that, you'll have to venture off on your own. The first rule of true contrarianism. Here is the fundamental feature of true contrarianism. If you don't remember anything from the next 9 chapters, remember this. If most believe something will happen in markets, the contrarian simply believes something else will. This is what the curmudgeons mess up. Note, I didn't say the opposite happens, just something different. Markets price into today's prices what the crowds commonly conceive. If everyone is bearish because they see bad things, they might be right that they're bad. But bad might not mean bearish. Because everyone sees the bad things and they're splashed all over the TV and internet, they might be priced in. Those bad things might not matter at all, or there could be some fundamentally big bad thing they aren't seeing at all, and things end up worse than they expect. This is what happened heading into 2008. Then, everyone said housing, subprime, and toxic mortgage-backed securities were trouble. They would cause a recession and make stocks fall. So many said it. So many saw it. No one, me included, saw an even bigger, quiet problem. November 2007's implementation of the market-to-market accounting rule, Statement of Financial Accounting Standards, FAS 157, Fair Value Measurements, which could wipe a couple $1 trillion off bank balance sheets globally. No one fathomed that because every financial institution would have to mark every illiquid asset on its balance sheet at the going market price, whenever others sold a mortgage-backed security at fire sale prices, everyone else would take a hit. Every bank in the U.S. would have to take a paper loss on every comparable illiquid security it owned. No one fathomed that this could cause pre-existing problems in subprime mortgages to eventually wipe out about $2 trillion from the U.S. banking system in mere months. No one fathomed that the fear over these opaque, illiquid markets could cause markets to deny funding first to Bear Stearns and then 6 months later to Lehman Brothers, triggering the demise of 2 of the 5 biggest investment banks. No one fathomed how the Fed, after lending J.P. Morgan Chase money to buy Bear, would deny funding to help Barclays buy Lehman, forcing the iBanking giant into bankruptcy. And no one fathomed how this would trigger sheer panic in the markets, making daily negative 8% drops seem the norm. Nor that through it all, the Fed would forget how to function in a crisis, forget to do most of what central banks traditionally did in a crisis, presuming all of that wouldn't work, forget to boost traditional liquidity by any measure or act as lender of last resort. If it were just subprime and housing in 2008, we'd probably have just gotten a big correction. It wasn't until around mid-year, as the vicious circle of fire sales and write-downs picked up in earnest, that the real trauma started. I missed it too. which brings up the second big rule of contrarianism. You'll be wrong sometimes. Contrarians know it, accept it. But you don't have to be right all the time to do fine. A 60% or 70% success rate keeps you well ahead of most. As I've written in past books, if you're right 70% of the time in this realm, you become an absolute living legend. Although it isn't impossible that all the snarky new blood-sucking ensures no new living legends ever emerge and endure ever again. Of course, a contrarian won't care about that, won't care about self-image. Despite what you may have read of me from my many critics, I care little about my image. Neither should you. The All-Seeing Market. Contrarians know when not to move and where not to go. How? They know markets are mostly efficient. Not fully, perfectly efficient at every moment, otherwise there would be no opportunities. Contrarians realize markets can be quite irrational in the short term, but over time and on average, prices typically reflect all widely known information. If it's out there in the public domain, investors have already considered it and traded on it. Rules, conventional wisdom, and consensus expectations are all widely known, ditto for ideological beliefs, biases, and every expert view. Every textbook theory, rulebook, and playbook ever published, markets know them inside and out. They know the rules, know the if-thens, and know how most folks are likely to react to every news nugget. Markets know what the crowd will do before the people themselves know. The same is true for seasonal myths and technical indicators. Dow theory is perhaps the most extreme example. This indicator, around since the late 19th century, says that when the Dow transports and industrials hit new highs together, you get a lasting bull trend. If they hit new lows together, look out below. There is also a lot of mumbo-jumbo in between, but I'll spare you. The extremes are what matter. If Dow theory were right, no bull market would ever end because the signal would keep on signaling and stocks would keep on rising. Same in a bear market. But cycles always turn. Markets have priced all those Dow theory expectations, and they'll ultimately do something different. Different, not opposite. Whatever the rules say and the herd expects, you can bet the markets won't do. But that doesn't mean the opposite outcome happens. Think back to our clock analogy. If everyone expects the hand to land on 1, the curmudgeon bets close to 7. The real contrarians remember markets are efficient, so they know the clock probably won't land between about 11 and 3. It would be too near where most folks expect. The contrarian can effectively rule out 4 possibilities, but there are still 8 hours worth of potential outcomes. For example, if most expect stocks to rise 10% in a year, true contrarians bet stocks probably won't land in the 5% to 15% range, but that still leaves a big up year, flat returns, or down. Understanding how markets discount known information helps you narrow the range of possibilities. It doesn't tell you what will happen. That's where curmudgeons get messed up. It just tells you what probably won't happen and frees you to contemplate what might happen and improve your odds. To narrow the field, the contrarian looks for things the herd and curmudgeons ignore. They branch out. Or they look at the same things but see them differently. Both actions let them find the risks and opportunities most others miss. The right frame of mind. Contrarians are patient. They think long-term. Short-term thinking makes you antsy, and that's when bad decisions happen. You see it all the time when folks chase heat, piling onto whatever is hottest purely because it is up the most. They might get bored with broad diversification during a rally and try to concentrate in a hot trend. They ditch long-term thinking for short. Think back to 1999 and 2000. Internet stocks flew high. Fiber optics was the next big thing. The Nasdaq soared and everyone wanted a piece of the new economy. Dot-coms seemed like the ultimate get-rich-quick magic. It's an extremely short-term mindset, but it viraled. Few thought about where they needed to be in 10 or 20 years. Of course, we're there now. Few looked a year ahead and considered whether companies with ultra-high cash burn rates and no revenues could still possibly be in business. They just wondered what was hot then, and they wanted as much as they could get. The bear market beginning in March 2000 was a rude awakening. Panic-stricken people think short-term, too. Go back to March 2009, those violent final throes of that financial panic. People truly believed stocks could go to zero. Don't believe me? Do a Google search on "Can the stock market go to zero?" They asked it. Markets were tanking. Zeroness felt real. You're probably sitting there thinking, that's not rational. But panic never is. Folks take those big losses and extrapolate them forward. They lose their grasp of history and reality. They forget the simple truths. Cycles always turn. Markets rise more often than not. As long as capitalism exists, businesses will find ways to profit and grow. New technologies will collide, bringing new growth and new sources of profits. This is what the steel-nerved contrarians believed in March 2009. Steely contrarians also look past short-term market movement. They know daily drops, quick pullbacks, and corrections are normal during bull markets, and reacting is dangerous. It usually means selling after stocks have already fallen, just when folks should hunker down and wait. Reacting to volatility is a good way to sell low, buy high. The same goes for seemingly big short-term events like geopolitical earthquakes. Skirmishes, minor wars, revolutions, and saber-rattling have plagued us since the dawn of civilization. Terrible as they are for lives and property of those in the line of fire, they usually aren't terrible, or even just plain bad, for stocks. Markets have dealt with conflict since before the first Dutch tulip changed hands, and only big, global, and nasty conflicts, like the onset of World War II, have ever ended in bull markets. Life always goes on, and the going on is what matters. Check your ego. As I said earlier, the contrarians know they won't be right all the time. Perfection is impossible. Even a practiced contrarian should expect to be wrong fully 30% to 40% of the time. You needn't be right any more than two-thirds of the time to do fine and stay ahead of the pack. Simply being right more often than wrong is huge and exceptional. As said, a professional who is right 70% of the time in the long term becomes an absolute living legend and had better also be used to being wrong 30% of the time. So you should be too. So how can you be right more often than wrong? I already told you. Remember, markets will do whatever the herd doesn't expect. But there are many ways to apply this simple rule. I'll detail them. Listen on. Chapter 2. For Whom the Bell Curve Tolls. In terms of rites and traditions, not much matches New Year's. If you ever went on Family Feud and this category came up, you'd have a field day. Champagne toasts, Auld Lang Syne, resolutions, Ryan Seacrest, Dick Clark for Greybeards, counting down before a big glittery ball drops on national television. Here's another. Professional investors' annual market forecasts. Will they pop up in a game show? No way. But knowing and understanding them can help you make more money than game shows ever can, assuming a 50-show Jeopardy run isn't in your future. Parsing professional forecasts can also help you develop one of the most basic principles of contrarianism, thinking different, not opposite. Wall Street strategists are far more gameable than retail investors. As my old research partner Mayer Statman and I found in a 2000 study for the Financial Analysts Journal, professional forecasters are wronger, stronger, and for longer than regular folks. Most individual investors are less stubborn and flip with trends. They won't stand being wrong for too long before they flip. If they're skeptical, 4 months of strong returns can turn them into bulls. If they're getting optimistic, it just takes one big pullback to flip them back to skeptics. Amateurs often have less confidence in their views. As Mayer and I found, when the media swings, individuals swing with them. The pros are more stubborn. As we wrote then, individual investors and newsletter writers form their sentiments as if they expect continuations of short-term returns. High S&P 500 returns during a month make them bullish. The sentiment of Wall Street strategists is little affected by stock returns. We found no statistically significant relationship between S&P 500 returns and future changes in the sentiment of Wall Street strategists. Pros don't flip like retail investors do. Their status breeds self-confidence. They're darn sure they know where markets are going and are willing to be patient. They don't give up the ghost, though they do mean revert. If their forecasts for a year are too dour, clearly behind the mark halfway through, they'll revise them up just a bit, and largely so they don't look ridiculous if the market finishes up strong. Many did this in 2014, pulling up their forecasts mid-year when markets had already exceeded their full-year forecast from mid-single-digit returns. Interestingly, the market then moved against them with a third-quarter stealth correction. That's the Great Humiliator in action. Armed with the knowledge that Wall Street pros are wronger, stronger, and longer, more often than not, we can game them. As we chronicled in Chapter 1, the curmudgeon posing as contrarian would say, if all the pros are bullish, you should be bearish, and if they're bearish, you should bullishly rage on. But as we'll see, this is too black and white. Professional market gurus are wrong an awful lot, but not because the market always does the opposite of what they say. Understanding how and why they're wrong, and why the market does what it does instead, is the first step to being right more often than wrong. In this chapter, we'll cover why most pros are mostly wrong most of the time, what their wrongness really tells you about what markets will and won't do, why nailing a forecast on the head isn't important. Wall Street's useless or useful fascination with calendars. Wall Street's fascination with calendar year return forecasts is largely foolish. Calendar year returns don't matter. It's true. Market cycles are what matter, and market cycles don't care about calendars. Rare is the bull or bear market that turns with the calendar page. No Standard & Poor's 500 index bull market since 1926 began in January, and only one, 1957 through 1961, ended in December. Maybe the next cycle aligns perfectly with the Roman calendar, or maybe it follows the lunar cycle. First time for everything. But nothing fundamentally changes when the calendar flips. Yet Wall Street is fascinated with calendar years, and pundits like making yearly forecasts. They get headlines and eyeballs, always a good thing for a pundit. They're splashy and easy for readers to make heads or tails of, just a number. A very specific number for an individual index. This makes them easy to track and grade, giving the pundits the aura of accountability, even if few bother filling out their report cards, and almost no one looks at report cards afterward. Everyone gets in on the action. The big wirehouses dedicate whole teams of economists and in-house gurus to the cause. Many fund managers do it with cult-like media following. Smaller pros may do it in their quarterly reports. Bloggers and columnists commonly tell you to the number where they think stocks will go. Individually, none of these forecasts are much use to the average investor. Numerical forecasts aren't much use for these folks' clients either. They're a sideshow. A pro's forecasting report card doesn't determine the returns their clients receive. Performance comes down to positioning. If they're positioned for a bull market and it pays off for clients, that matters far more than whether they predicted 7% or 20% in an 18% year. The trick for professional forecasts is to use them without using them. Nope, you heard right. If you collect the whole batch of professional forecasts for a year, you get a marvelous snapshot of the general direction and magnitude Wall Street expects. And that gives you a pretty good idea of what the market likely discounts, and hence won't happen. Wall Street pros aren't the only ones fascinated with calendars. Firms are, too. My father, Phil Fisher, always complained about this. He saw himself more as a business analyst than a stock market analyst, and he'd say publicly traded firms are way too focused on this year's or next year's earnings per share, always thinking in calendar years. If they were private, he said, they'd think much longer term. If they had the chance to make an investment with a sky-high return over 20 years, they'd care less about upfront costs, business cycles, and the reality of short-term losses. They'd care much more about the total return at the end of those 20 years, net of all those occasional big losses. When a business starts a plant, the project bleeds cash. Planning, architecture, and construction drain capital. Businesses hyper-focused on calendar year earnings might not take the plunge, regardless of how much it could enhance growth and earnings down the line. So, how'd we get so taken with calendars? We bred it into ourselves centuries ago. It all ties back to our agricultural roots, where the calendar really does matter. Weather patterns are seasonal. Harvest time comes every year, and in the 19th century, one year's results mattered. Whether we're talking farming, ranching, or logging and milling, harvest time is harvest time. It comes once a year. Go back to the dawn of markets, and most American employment was in agriculture. Manufacturing was tiny, and service was scant. You had merchants and banks, but not the huge service industries of today. Agriculture dominated, and so did its mindset. So we applied calendars to everything with rigor. Survival depended on it. It evolved into our core. Those who didn't failed to pass their genes on. Breaking free of Wall Street's love of calendars helps you think differently. Calendar year returns aren't important. Whether a bull market lasts 2 years or 10 years, that's important. Returns in each of those calendar years, not so much. The overall return, net of all the corrections and pullbacks, is what gets you to your goals. If you measured market returns in rolling 14-month periods instead of rolling 12-month segments, it would be just as valid. Professional groupthink. Professional forecasters tend to fall into groupthink. They'll never admit it. They'll all swear their views are unique, smarter, superior. Some surely are. Yet professional forecasts have a remarkable tendency to cluster. There are always outliers. Usually a few pros get it right each year, whether they're right for the right reasons or just plain lucky. But the bulk tend to fall in a pretty tight range, giving the market, the great humiliator, an easy target. A big chunk of experts to humiliate in one fell swoop. What TGH discounts into current prices. The pros don't deliberately cluster, per se, but they all use the same information, and they tend to interpret it in similar ways. What they agree on, the consensus, is the crowd, the herd, or whatever you want to call what the market discounts in pricing and what the contrarian must avoid. Fundamentalists all look at the same Federal Reserve policies, economic pluses and minuses, interest rates, valuations, and politics, and they all make the same assumptions about what's good and what's bad for stocks. And most are pretty, well, conventional one way or another. They all have the same tendency to mean revert, betting on the long-term average by assuming small or down years following big years. The technical analysts all use the same charts, patterns, and rule sets. It's all the same widely known information the rest of the herd chews over daily. Dow theorists follow Dow theory. Those following Robert Shiller share the same broad interpretation of the wonky, smoothed 10-year price-to-earnings ratio he spearheaded, also known as CAPE, cyclically adjusted P.E. As a result, everything the pros agree on is priced. Their expectations for how events and developments will impact stocks? Priced. Perceived risks discussed in reports and articles? Priced. Market reality is exceedingly unlikely to occur as they expect. Even if certain events follow their predictions to a T, the market reaction probably won't. Contrarians get this. They know most investors will share the pros' expectations. The media reports professional forecasts far and wide, and that influences most folks' outlooks. Investing as a science, folks, will often agree with the gurus who use similar methodology, logic, and theory. Technicians usually side with the pros who use the same chart patterns and rules. Contrarians also know the curmudgeons will expect the opposite direction. How the contrarian uses professional forecasts. Contrarians know the bulk of professional forecasts are priced. Won't happen. But what exactly is priced? The actual number? If the consensus says 6%, would TGH hit them with 8%? It might, but probably not. Wouldn't be nearly fun enough. Here's the secret. The actual number isn't so important. Markets look more at the general bucket. A 6% forecast is really just a prediction for returns somewhere in the low to mid-single digits. The difference between a 6% and 8% forecast largely is without meaning. If that's where the bulk of professional forecasts fall, that's your clue the market probably won't land in that bucket. It might. TGH might decide to attack the curmudgeon anti-herd instead of the main herd. It has before. We'll get to that. But more often than not, the market will end up doing something very different than what the bulk of professional forecasters expect. Tracking the pros is easier than you think. Just take some Googling and basic Excel work, and if you don't know Excel, you can Google that too. One of the Internet's many miracles is its vast volume of technical tutorials. So with minimal time and perseverance, you can do what we do at my firm. Though I warn you, few listeners ever will, because it is countersensical. Every year, my firm's research staff rounds up all the professional forecasts for major countries' benchmark indexes, S&P 500 for the U.S., DAX for Germany, Nikkei for Japan. You get the gist. For each country, we throw all the numbers into a simple chart. Histogram, if you want to get technical. On the horizontal axis, we break the return spectrum down into 5% ranges. 0% to 5%, 5% to 10%, 10% to 15%, and so on. Then, in each range, we stack up every forecast that lands in it. It's like stacking Lego bricks with numbers on them. What you usually end up with is a bell curve formation, with the fat part showing you the range where forecasts are most tightly clustered. If forecasts are clustered in the 0% to 5% and 5% to 10% ranges, that tells you most folks think markets will be up a little bit, single digits. Again, differences without distinction. If they're all in the low negative and low positive single digits, you know most expect a flattish year. If they're in the 10% to 20% brackets, folks expect a decent bull year. And if they're in the negative 10% to negative 20% range, most expect a bear market. Once you identify the direction and magnitude the crowd expects, you know what probably won't happen. It's even easier to narrow than you think. In broad terms, markets really do only four things: go up a little, up a lot, down a little, or down a lot. Four outcomes. Maybe five, if you count flat. Though that's happened exactly once in the S&P 500's history, 1947. As Casey Stengel said, you can look it up. You can cross one of these broad outcomes off the list of potentials just by looking at the curve. Whichever of those four ranges the cluster lands in, you eliminate it. This gives you three other choices. If everyone expects stocks to go up a little, TGH could surprise them with down a little. But it could also blow them away with up a lot, or make them look foolish with down a lot. Curmudgeons, of course, would disagree with this. If the pros say up a little, curmudgeons assume down. If the pros say up a lot, curmudgeons plan for the apocalypse. Sometimes the curmudgeons are right, but banking on their assumptions won't work with any sort of repeatability. TGH likes to thwack them, too. To figure out which outcome is most likely, you must figure out whether the pros are overlooking opportunities or risks. We'll cover this in the next few chapters. Listen to what the talking heads chatter about. What do they think are risks? What do they like? That tells you it's probably priced. Where aren't they looking? What are they misinterpreting? That's where you find real risks and opportunities. Then look for things the crowd might be missing, and look globally. Are most folks overlooking bad monetary policy in multiple major countries? The existence of bad monetary policy isn't enough. If everyone sees it, it is probably already baked into stock prices. You're looking for things very few others discuss. Are new tariffs and restrictions about to make trade nosedive, yet no one notices? Are nasty regulations about to pound profits and not yet understood by most, as with 2008's market-to-market accounting implemented within weeks of the 2007 market peak? Of course, the sheer existence of these unseen risks isn't enough to make stocks fall a lot. Markets move on probabilities, not possibilities. You have to weigh the probability of whatever unseen risks you spot actually coming true and whacking the world. Being out of stocks is one of the biggest risks long-term growth investors can take. If they're wrong and they're on the sidelines in a big bull year, that's a ton of lost ground to make up. My January ritual. I play the January game, too. It's an annual requirement in Forbes, and my clients want it. They know our forecast for the next 12 to 18 months drives our positioning, and they want to know why we're doing what we're doing, as well they should. But I try not to play the numbers game. Numbers don't matter. Bull markets are bull markets. If I forecast 15%, but stocks do 30%, was I wrong? Or was I right because the bull market continued and my positioning would have been the same either way? So I forecast ranges. In my January Forbes columns and my firm's quarterly report for clients, the forecast is up a lot, up a little, down a lot, or down a little. If you have to put numbers on it, you can think of up a lot as up 20% or more, up a little as 0% to 20%, down a little as negative 0% to negative 20%, and down a lot as negative 20% or greater. But here, too, nothing is ironclad. If I said up a lot and stocks did 16%, I'd be feeling pretty good. We'd be positioned right, and 16% is a fine bull market return. Bear markets add a wrinkle. Many bears don't feature full-year down-a-lot returns. You could very well have a bear market cover the last half of one year and first half of another, and see positive returns in both. Much of forecasting is simply about determining whether the cycle is likely to change. If you start the year in a bull market, what's the likelihood a bear starts at some point? If you start the year in a bear market, what's the likelihood a bull starts before year end? Think of a year like 1987. It went from bull to bear and back again, all between August 25th and December. Full year returns? Up a hair. If you predicted up a hair but missed the bear, were you really that good? Not that most predicted that in 1987. When the year started, pros were uniformly bullish. Stocks were up about 150% in 4 years, and many forecasters extrapolated those returns forward, up, up and away. As I wrote in Forbes that January, sentiment was so high that my carpenter, John, was predicting a big up year. Why? Heard it on TV. He wasn't the only one. As I detailed in my June 1987 column, many investors were flipping from fear to greed as the extraordinary bull market has disoriented many folks' investment expectations.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.